Very pleased to speak in this very nice seminar, and thank you for attending. So before giving this talk, I would like to make some publicity. So it will be from the conference, the Journée Arithmétique. It will be in Nancy, in France. So Philippe is one of the scientific committee, and I am one of the members of the organizing committee. So if you want to have some information, don't hesitate to contact me. And there is a website here, and the inscription are open still today. And perhaps many of you have received an email for this. Voilà. And you are, everybody is welcome. So now I will begin my talk. I am very pleased to present a joint work with James Menard about quartic polynomial values with a large prime factor. So I will begin with a famous conjecture in number theory. So it says that if we take P of X, a polynomial irreducible with no fixed divisor, that is, we want doesn't want a polynomial like n squared plus n plus 2 because this polynomial is always even. So a conjecture says that there are infinitely many integers n such that P of n is prime. So when the degree of P is equal to 1, this is a consequence of Dirichlet's theorems on the primes in arithmetic progressions. If P is of type A times X plus B with coprime integers A and B, the Dirichlet's theorems say that there are infinitely many primes P which are congruent to B modulo A, so in the shape B plus A times X. But when the degree of P is bigger than 2, it is still an open problem. But we have a nice result from Ivanets, obtained in 1978. So he proved that there are infinitely many n such that n squared plus 1 has at most 2 prime factors. So we have 2. Actually, we can't replace 2 by 1. But it's not so. We have the meaning that it's not so far. But we are not also able to prove that there are infinitely many n such that n squared plus 1 has exactly 2 prime factors. So at most also is important. And when the degree of the polynomial is big, the problem is more difficult because the sequence P of n is a spare sequence. If D is the degree of the polynomial P, then the gap between 2 consecutive values of P, it is quite big. It is of the size n to the d minus 1. So the problem becomes more and more difficult. And when a problem is very difficult, we try to attack a simpler one. And in simpler one would be to try to find polynomial values with large prime factors. Alors, what is large? That means, so we would like to find polynomial values P of n with a prime factor, say, of the size n to the d. But we are very far from that. Sorry. And this is what I name the problem of Chebyshev. So we want to detect the polynomial values with a large prime factor. So I will denote by p plus of n, the largest prime factors of n, and p minus of n, the smallest one. And so what can we say about the large prime factors of n to plus 1? Does there exist integers n such that n squared plus 1 has large prime factors? And what it is easy to do, it is possible, it is easy to find integers n less than x with such that n squared plus 1 has the prime factors of this size. So it is sufficient to take a prime p a little less than x, for example, less than x divided by 1,000, p is congruent to 1 mod 4. In this case, we can find some solution v such that v2 plus 1 is congruent to 0 mod p. And then, if n is congruent to v mod p, then p will divide n squared plus 1. And so n squared plus 1 will have a prime factor bigger than p, and so bigger than x. So we can do that for this polynomial n to plus 1. We can generalize that to other polynomials. And the natural question is, can we do better? And Chebyshev, in a manuscript posthume, answered yes. So it is the next slide. So Chebyshev. So what he did. So we can look at all the values taken by the polynomial x squared plus one. So we take the product, and we want to detect the largest prime factors of this product, and we normalize, and then we take the limit as x tends to infinity, and it proves that this limit tends to infinity. And it was the beginning of a lot of nice results. So it was improved during the last century by several mathematicians. I won't recall all the results here, but actually the best general result is the result obtained by Tenenbaum. So what it is, this result, it is if we take F, this time it is F, an irreducible polynomial with degree bigger than two, then for X large enough, we can find integers N less than X such that F of N has a large prime factors. Large means here bigger than X times exponential this power of log X. So alpha, the exponent alpha here must be less than 2 minus log 4, that is 0.61. So here it is the best general result, but perhaps it would be possible to obtain some better result when the degree of F is small. So here you would like to have X to the degree of F. So we are far from that. But when the degree of F is small, we can obtain here lower bound. Can we obtain a lower bound with the power of X greater than one? And this was done by Goulet for the first time. So up to the next slide here. So for the quadratic polynomials. So we fix an integer D, which is not a square. And then Hooley proved that we can find integers N less than X such that N to the square minus D has a prime factor bigger than X to the 1.1. So for this result, he used some sieve methods. And then there was some exponential sums, that is a Clostermann sums. I won't give the definition here. And in the 80s, Dizouyer and Ivanets obtained strong estimates from average on average Clostermann sums. And they used some modular form theory. And so they could improve the 1.1 here by 1.2 and so on. And very recently, there was two improvements by Labrotech and Trappot here, and also by Mirikovsky. Now we are going to the cubic case. For the cubic case, it is a little more complicated, so the results are not so good. But we can also obtain something. So Hooley, in the 1978, he obtained this result. Basically, this result is a conditional result. It holds under an hypothesis for the order of magnitude of very short Clostermann sums. And it was only in the beginning of our millennium that there was an unconditional result. It was the one of Hisbron. He proved that we can find a positive proportion of integers n such that n to the cube plus 2 has a prime factor bigger than x to a power strictly bigger than 1. So it is 1 plus 10 to the minus 303. So we can see that it is very small, but in fact, it is strictly bigger than 1. And we will see in the next slide that it is not so small. And Irving proved that we can replace X exponent by that. So now we are arriving to the quartic polynomials. And some years ago, I solved the problems for polynomials of degree 4. It was here the 12 cyclotomic polynomial. So here there should be some parentheses here. And so I proved that we can find integers n such that n to the 4 minus n squared plus 1 has a prime factors bigger than n to this power here. So this power is very small, but I must say that it was quite a lot of work to obtain an effective power here. Even if it is very, very small, for me, it wasn't easy to obtain that. So I was happy with this exponent. And Régis de Labrotèche generalized my result to polynomials of degree 4, irreducible, even, monic, and with Galois group isomorphic to the Klein group, that is z divided by 2z times this z divided by 2z. Then he proves that there exists an exponent CP strictly positive, so just depending on the polynomial P, such that there is a positive proportion of integers n between x and 2x, such that P of n has a large prime factor. So in this theorem, the condition to be even is not very important. It is only to make the computation easier. But what is crucial here, it is the Galois group. The hypothesis with the Galois group is important here. And in fact, for the 12 cyclotomic polynomials, the Galois group of these polynomials is also the Klein group. So now it is time to the next slide. So I will put the theorems that I will present today. It's a theorem obtained with James Menard. So we take a polynomial P as in the result of Régis de la Bretèche, irreducible, monic, and quartic. And this time, the Galois group can be isomorphic to the cyclic group or to the dihedral group. Then we have the same conclusion. We can find a positive proportion of integers n between x and 2x, such that P of n has a prime factor bigger than x to the 1 plus CP. So it remains to handle the case when the Galois group is the symmetric group and the alternate group. And in fact, if we take a random polynomial irreducible of degree 4, its Galois group is in general the cyclic or alternate. So we can only handle a minority of quartic polynomials. But it is at least a progress. And so we can handle, for example, the fifth cyclotomic polynomial here. I give also some other examples. And also, sorry, and there was also a natural polynomial that we couldn't handle before. It was x to the 4 plus 2, which has a dihedral Galois group. So the proof is very long. It is 80 pages.
And now, can I ask a short question? Is the constant implied in the theorem uniform in the polynomials or no?
No, it depends strongly on the polynomials. And in fact, it will be very complicated to compute. So we need to work a lot. So I have said my previous theorems for the 12 cyclotomic polynomials, I suffered, I must say, to obtain an effective constant. But perhaps it is possible to have, if we have a lot of energy, it is possible to obtain an expression of CP, of an admissible constant CP, depending on the polynomial P. But there are many algebraic things, the unit, something like that. We need to know that.
What about the part greater than x, the constant implied there, that's also depending on?
Yes, so the constant depends also on the polynomial. And also, it would have a complicated expression. But it is, if we have, it is possible to obtain something, but not easy. Yes, are there other questions? No? So don't hesitate to interrupt me. Thank you. And so now I will try to give an overview of the proof. And so the first step is to try to detect polynomial values with large prime factors. And here we follow the method of Hirschsprung. And the first lemma is an adaptation of a result of Hirschsprung. We did it for the degree 3. But in fact, this lemma can be also works also for other degree polynomials. The constant will change in some parts. So we take P, a polynomial irreducible with a quartic and so. And I will denote by R1 root of P and NP, the norm in the extension of Q given by R1. Then I will consider a curious set. It is a set E of delta of the integers N in between capital X and 2X, such that if we look at the principal ideal generated by N minus R1, and we look at the primes ideals in the factorization of these principal ideals, and we want to compute the norm of P, and we want that this norm is not bigger than X. If the product of such norm is not so small means bigger than x to the 1 plus delta, where delta is a strictly positive parameter. So it will be our set here. So the method of Hirschsprung says if we are able to find two constants, delta 0, delta 1, strictly positive, such that the cardinality of E of delta 0 of this set here is bigger than delta 1 times x, then for x large enough, we will find a positive proportion of integers x with a large, such that P of n has a large prime factors. So with this bound here and here. So there are some explicit things. But so in fact, I switched to ideals quickly, but in fact, we could reformulate this lemma with prime factors of P of n because we can interpret P of n as a norm of the ideals given by n minus R1. So to look at the prime ideals here, it is quite the same to look at the prime factors of n. So in fact, we are detecting P of n with a large divisor formed by prime factors of size less than x. And so what we will see soon that it is nice to switch to ideals. But the idea behind this lemma is that in general, if we take an integer n, then P of n has at most three prime factors bigger than 4 times x because n p is of degree 4. So P of n is less than x to the 4 times a constant. So we can't have 4 prime factors like that. And when n is in the set delta 0, then P of n has at least a large divisor formed by small powers. And so P of n has at most 2 prime factors in this sense. So we play with these things, and with that we can prove lemma one. So, but it is the idea in lemma one is that. So now, by lemma one, we need to have a set of integers n with such that n minus R1 belongs to some nice ideals J. So here I won't be very precise, but I will consider a set of ideals of the integer ring associated to R1. I consider a set of principal ideals satisfying many, many conditions that I won't quote in the slides. But what I will impose here that we want that the largest prime factors of the norm less than x, and we want that these things, this inequality, the norm is not so small. Why I do that? So it is here because of this condition here. So we want p plus of less than x, and we want this inequality here. This is why I made this condition here and this condition here. With these two conditions, A1 will be a subset of E delta zero. It will be sufficient to have a lower bound of that. Now I have here, it will be to make the things easier. And I will add this condition here in order to have this lower bound here. Because if all the prime factors of the norm of J is like that, then an integer n will be n minus R1, the norm will have a finite. Sorry, I try to reformulate. With this condition here, we can deduce that n minus R1 will belong in at most 2 to the 4 times b ideal G, like that. So we can have this lower bound below. Sorry, I'm not very clear here. And so now we need to study the integers n between x and 2x such that n minus R1 belongs to an ideal J, where J is an ideal like that. So it is this step. And so now we need to understand this condition. How can we understand that? It is the next slide. So now we would like to understand this because here it is integer, it is the root of a polynomial, and here it is an ideal in an integer ring. So can we switch to only with integers. So I will take G, J, a principal ideals generated by alpha. So I will, and I can choose alpha so that with A0, A1, A2, A3, and integers. And I will work with, I propose to work with a particular case, the case x squared plus 2. So that we will have the root to the fourth would be equal to minus 2. And the starting ideas to study this congruence is very simple. It is to remark that alpha belong to J, R1 alpha also belong to J, and the square of R1 alpha belong to J. It is only this trivial observation. So alpha belongs to J means that A0 plus A1 R1 plus A2 times the square of R1 plus A3 like that is congruent to 0 modulo J. So I put the minus hero A0 here, and then I multiply this equality by R1. So A0 becomes A0 R1, and so on. And here, A3 times the cube of R1 multiplied by R1, it will be A3 times R1 to the 4. So it will be minus 2 times A3. And so we will have a second equation here. We do the same by multiplying by R1 to the square. And we obtain here three equations where when the unknown are R1, the square, and the cube. And so we can formulate here with the system. And now we can use the Cramer formula. And by the Cramer formula, we will see that we can have an equation, R1 times the determinant here is congruent to the determinant here, that is this determinant by replacing the first column by this one, modulo J. And in fact, we can switch by some algebraic consideration, we can replace G by the norm of G. And in the next slide, we will have a general lemma. So it is here. So I come back to this lemma. So now we have a general polynomial. We take again alpha. And I wanted to see that this determinant, sorry, I come back to the previous slide. These determinants are special determinants. In fact, these determinants are cofactors of the matrix of multiplication by alpha in the basis 1, R1, the square of R1, the cube of R1. And it is this, we can prove the same for every polynomial. And so I will introduce some notation. So I take G, principally an ideal generated by alpha, and M alpha be the matrix of the multiplication by alpha in the basis 1, R1, the square of R1, the cube. And I will denote by capital B, IG, the cofactor matrix. And the lemma 2 says that if this cofactor here is coprime to the norm of alpha, then we can have a sort of parametrization of this congruence. We have the n minus r1 belongs to the ideal generated by alpha if and only if n is congruent to this things modulo np alpha. So b here it is another cofactor, and the bar here means the inverse. So now we have a congruence with only integers. And when we have that, we can detect the n between x and 2x satisfying this congruence by exponential sums. And so we arrive to these things. So we need to evaluate. We use the notation E of t is equal to exponential 2i pt. And then we need to have a non-trivial bound of this exponential. So we have an exponential sums with four variables, the coordinates of alpha, A0, A1, A2, A3, are in sort of domain D, so I won't describe it, but we can do such that we can control the size of the AE. And here we have a polynomial, three polynomials depending on A0, A1, A2, A3. The problem is that the denominator here NP of alpha depends on A0, A1, A2, A3. So we would like to eliminate one variable, for example, A0. So what we want to do, so I'm perhaps going too fast, it is to make an approximation of this rational fraction by another one, where in the denominator here, we will suppress the A0. It is the next slide. So to do that, we can use resultant. So I will write, so it is not very important here, I'll write the coefficient of P of X, and I will define R0, the resultant. Alors, it would be natural to take the resultant between B14 on the norm of alpha, but in fact, it is more efficient to take a resultant between two cofactors, B13 and B14. And we take the resultants relative to A0. And then we can compute, in fact, by using SAGE, for example. And we can see that R0 have this nice factorization property, where Q3 is a quadratic form with an explicit value here. And Q, it would be too long to write it on the slide, but it is a form homogeneous in degree 6. And then, sorry, I hope it's okay. By the resultant theory, we can find two polynomials U and V, and also we can compute it by SAGE, such that U times this cofactor plus V times B14 is Q times Q3. And so then doing some computation, and with this, we have our approximation. So I recall the notation E of T, it is exponential 2IPT. And then our previous term here, it is close to this part here, plus, I have forgotten an H here, but it's not important, H times this rational fraction. This rational fraction is not very important. What we can say, its size is quite small, and we can remove this part by partial summation, so we can forget it. And so this lemma means that this exponential sums, this exponential term is very close to this thing. It's okay? Perhaps by usually when I give talk, I'm going too fast, I'm sorry. So I will, the next slide, summarize in which step we are. What we need to do now? We need to be able, for many A1, A2, A3 given, for many of them, we need to be able to bound non-trivially the sums of types, the sum of A0 in an interval like that. Q depends not, so Q doesn't depend on A0, Q depends only of A1, A2, A3. And this polynomial U on B14 depends on A0, A1, A3. A trivial bound of these sums, it is the size, the length of the interval, it is B. And usually, when we meet such sums in analytic number theory, we hope to be able to use the veil bounds coming from arithmetic geometry. And the veil bound says that we can bound that, it is a capital, a big O of the square root of the denominator. But here it is too big, because you recall that Q is a form of degree 6. So the size of Q is B to the 6, which is, if we take the square root, it will be B to the cube, and it will be too big comparatively to the trivial bound. So we need to bound that B to a power strictly less than 1. Voilà. And Woolley in the cubic case have a Clostermann sum, so it would be polynomials of degree 1 here and some nothing here. The interval here was very short. And the hypothesis that I mentioned in the beginning of my talk, it was for this step. And Hirschsprung solved these things, because he observes that if Q has a good shape, we can obtain no non-trivial bound. So it is the next slide. It is a result of Hirschsprung. on short exponential sums. So we take two polynomials f and g of degree d, and another thing, it is a denominator q, which q is square free, and also it has localized divisor. So we can factorize q as q0 times q1 times q4. And so there are other technical conditions here that I won't describe. And what he proved, so we consider the sum here on the n in this interval, such that g of n is coprime to q, because here it is the inverse of g of n modulo q. And the bond, so the bond here, it is less than the modulo of these sums is less than the trivial things, so the length of interval times a very small power of q. And here in the bracket is what we can win. So here we win something if q0 is not too small, if q0 is bigger than that. And here a good news, we win something, we win something here if here it is less than a negative power of b. So we have some place q0 must be less than the square of b. It is a very good. And here, also what it is very good, we win something if the qi is less, or a little less than the length of the interval, b to the 1 minus epsilon 0. And what it is also nice is that the integer k can be as large as we want. So we can have k is equal to 10 and also on. So if we are we would like to use this bond. To use this bond, we need to find many integers a1, a2, n3 in a small box such that the denominator q, a1, a2, a3 is square free and also have a nice factorization. Q is equal to q0 with q0 quite big of the size b square. And the q1, q2, q4 are close to b, b to the 1 minus something. But in fact, it is not always easy to do that. And so we need to understand the form q, because q is a degree 6. So what is the form q? It is the next slide. The form q, the problem of to understand the form q was solved by Labretèche and Mestre. So they obtained a very general result for the shape of q. So you remember that q times another quadratic form, it was the resultant of two cofactors of a matrix by some multiplication. And so they proved that they obtained a precise description of the form q. So if r1, r2, r3, and r4 are the root of the polynomial p, then we can define these things I0. So a, it is a0 plus a1 times a and so on. On q, the absolute value of q, what it is these things. It is the different product I of evaluate at the root a minus a evaluated at rj divided by r. It is difficult for me to pronounce the difference of the roots. And we take all the possible product, the a and j, between 1 and 4 on this time, and so with no repetition. And so here we see the importance of the Galois group, because the Galois group of P has an influence of Q on Q. When the Galois group of P is the alternate groups of on the symmetric groups, this form is irreducible. And we are not able actually to find many A1, A2, A3 such that Q has a nice factorization. In my work for the 12 cyclotomic polynomials and the work of Régis de Labretèche, the Galois group was a Klein group. And in this case, Q is a product of three quadratic forms, q1, q2, q3. So we have naturally divisor. We can split naturally q in divisor. And then by some counting with some lattice arguments, we can estimate. So it is a technical, the first technical slice, not the first. So we can evaluate it, the number of A1, A2, A3 in given interval, such that the Q1 evaluated A1, A2, A3, and also have a nice divisor M1, M2, M3. And so we can control, we can put some condition on M1, M2, M3. So we can say that M1 is a product of two big prime factors. And what it is nice here is that we can take here the size of M1, M2, M3, the products can be big as a cube of B minus epsilon. And so with these things, we can find many integers A1, A2, A3, such that Q has a nice factorization. But this works only for the Klein group. For the dihedral, when the Galois group is dihedral and cyclic, the situation is not so good, but it is not so bad. We don't have three quadratic forms, but we have a form of degree 4 and a form of degree 2. So the previous method doesn't work, but the form of degree 4 is very special. So when the Galois group is cyclic octahedral, we can order the root of P, if I name it R1, R2, R3, R4, such that R1 times R2 plus R3 times R4 is rational. So here it is what we name a root of some cubic circulant associated to the polynomial Spi. And one of the roots in our case is rational. And what we observe is that the form Q1 is in fact an incomplete norm forms. This is a norm of this element, A1 plus A2 times this plus A3 times this, in the extension generated by R1 plus R3. And this is an extension of degree 4. And since it is a norm, there is some multiplicative structures behind that. And so we can do something. And there have been in this millennium, since the beginning of the 2000 years, but very nice results of primes represented by incomplete norms on other forms. So I take the opportunity of my talk to give some history of that. And so in Friedlander and Ivanets, it gave the first very spectacular results on this field. They proved, they obtained an asymptotic formula for the primes represented by the form A form plus B square. It is very impressive because there are very few integers of this type. And if we would like to bound the number of n less than x such that n is of the type A4 plus B square, there is at most a capital times x to the 3/4 in such integers. And so there are some generalization by Isborn and Lee, and also by Merikoski. And another very impressive results in analytic number theory. It was a result obtained by Hisbron. He obtained an asymptotic formula for the primes of the form A3 plus 2B3. So here again, it is a very sparse sequence. So there are at most a capital O of X to the 2 divided by 3 integers less than X of this type. So we can actually, you can find forms like that. And then it is natural to try to obtain such result in more variables for incomplete norms with more variables. And this was achieved by James Menard recently. And I will present here his result. So it is, we take now F, an irreducible polynomial with integer coefficient, theta, a root of F, and K is a field generated by theta, and N the norm. And so small k will be the number of excluded variables. And so what he looked, we want to count the number of A1, A to the N minus k, such that the norm of A1 plus a2 times theta plus a3 times theta squared and so on. But we stop at n minus k. We want that this norm is prime. And he obtained an asymptotic formula with expecting things. And this formula is in the case when if k is a number of excluded variables, the degree of f must be bigger than 4k. In fact, he has also another result with not an asymptotic things, but with a lower bound of the good order of magnitude. Here we can almost replace k by 3. It's not exactly 3, it is 22 divided by 7, but it is not so far from 3. And if we replace 4 by 22 by 7, we have a lower bound on here. And for us, you remember our form Q1 is of degree 4, and we have one excluded variables. And so for k is equal to 1, we can take n bigger than 4. So it is good for us. And so the idea we can hope to adapt some ideas of the proof of Minard to our problem. So you remember, we need to find a Q1 with localized divisor on Q2 also. I come back, perhaps you have forgotten because here, Q, it is Q1 of degree 4 on Q2 of degree 4. Hop. So, sorry, it is here. And it was, we did that. So in the proof of Maynard, there was some Harman sieve combinatorial, very complicated sieve method. So it is a very long paper, more than 100 pages, 122. So it is very, very many things in it. And in analytic number theory, we meet the type one sum. It was a sum that we meet for the Klein group and the type two sums. And our problem is quite a type two sums problems because we want to detect values with a very, very large divisor. So larger than the natural barrier. And so what we proved, so now it will be, we can, what we did, we can find integers a1, a2, a3 in some boxes such that q1 is a multiplus of a product of primes, q2 is a multiplus of a small primes, where the size of the primes here is quite big, bigger than the natural limit b, the cube of b. In fact, the size here is very close to b to the 4. So I will soon finish. So I will do a more complicated formulation. Sorry, there will be a lot of notation. So, and in fact, our result may be likely generalized to many forms, but we wanted to obtain a result sufficient for our problem. But I think it is possible to have a more general result. So we take K a quartic extension of Q. Okay, I denote by O its integer ring, and I take a basis, nu1, nu2, nu3, nu4, z basis of k, such that nu1 is equal to 1, and k is generated by nu2, and f is the quadratic form q2. And so we suppose that if p is congruent to 1 modulo some integer d depending on f, f split very well modulo p in two linear forms. And so we are considering the a1, a2, a3 in some box, so on some size x, such that d divides q1, our q1, it is this norm, incomplete norm form, and p divides q2, here q2 is the quadratic polynomial f. So we want to have this, and in this term, we add some congruence condition of the a1, a2, a3. And I don't know, I hope that you can see here. Our result is, so I don't give all the hypotheses, but we have some estimate like that. And what it is, the main difference with the work of James Maynard is that this new here, because we can have an average condition of the P0 when P0 is bigger than the power of X. So here, the congruence here, we can only handle when the modulus m is less than the power of log x. But for the form q2, we need to be under congruence modulus bigger than the power of x. It was the main difference with the work of James. And I will give briefly the ingredient of proof. So as we said, we switched to ideals in UK to have some multiplicative things. And then we use some sieve weights. So I will go here very quickly. Some dispersion method, it is tool from analytic number theory. And then we meet some a lot of lattices counting arguments. And here, it was necessary to have a form here and not an individual congruence. So, and it is finished. Thank you very much.